Well, hello everyone and welcome to the Bracy Sports Media Podcast. This is episode 8. It is Friday, May 10th, 2024, and we have a jam-packed show in front of us today. We'll be joined in just a bit by Jackie Spiegel, who covers the Philadelphia Flyers for the Philadelphia Inquirer. Really looking forward to talking to Jackie about the Flyers last season and a look ahead to this offseason, very important offseason for the Flyers. We're also going to be talking about the Phillies, 76ers, Eagles, and the Big Five. We'll see how much we can get in today. If you're listening to this podcast on the Bracy Sports Media YouTube page, thank you very much. I would be grateful if you can subscribe. If you're listening on Apple or Spotify, you can follow the podcast there. And also you can find the podcast on the YouTube page or on Apple, Spotify, etc. The website is big5hoops.com. The hashtags on social media are hashtag Philly Sports, hashtag Big5Hoops, and hashtag 0304 St. Joe's Book. And you can find me on social media at Aaron, A-A-R-O-N, underscore Bracy. And okay, got that out of the way. And now let's start talking some sports. It's going to be Phillies are back in action tonight. Why don't we start there with the Phillies? They ended an 11-game home winning streak on Wednesday against the Blue Jays. Phillies are still on a roll. They've won 18 of 22. First place in the NL East, two games ahead of the Braves. Tied with the Dodgers for the best record in baseball. Phillies are off to a great start, one of their best starts in franchise history. They have three against the Marlins beginning tonight, beginning Friday night at 7:10. And then they will play two in New York against the Mets on Monday and Tuesday before returning home for a five-game homestand that begins Wednesday against the Mets. The Marlins are 10-29. They are currently 16.5 games back of the Phillies. Certainly on paper, this looks like a series the Phillies should at least get two out of three, if not sweep. The pitching matchup for the Phillies looks like this. On Friday night, they're going to send Ranger Suarez to the hill. 6-0 with a 1.72 ERA. On Saturday evening, late afternoon, Taiwan Walker will take the mound. Taiwan is 2-0 with a 6.39 ERA, and they'll finish it up on Sunday with their ace, Zach Wheeler, who is 4-3 with a 1.64. So certainly, on paper, it would seem like Friday and Sunday are going to be really tough matchups for the Marlins with Suarez and Wheeler. Taiwan Walker has been good through six innings in his two starts, has given up homers in the seventh inning of both of his starts, so his ERA is inflated, although I think he's pitched better than his ERA. So the Phillies will be back in action on Friday night. 76ers are not in action, as we all know, but there was an interesting story on Thursday in the Philadelphia Inquirer from Keith Pompey, who does a fantastic job covering the 76ers for the Inquirer. Kyle Lowry, the former Villanova standout, spoke to Keith and told him how much he enjoyed playing for the 76ers this season and that he does plan to return for a 19th NBA season next year. What a career it's been for Kyle Lowry out of Cardinal Doherty and Villanova. In 23 games for the Sixers this year, Kyle averaged 8 points and 4.6 assists. So while we're on Villanova, maybe we can touch on the Big Five. Of course, you can find my coverage at big5hoops.com. It's a little slow right now. It'll pick up again during the season. I will also be doing some off-season stuff when news breaks and as we get closer to the season. The big story, a big question for me right now is what happens with Eric Dixon? Will Eric Dixon return to Villanova? Will he stay in the NBA draft? He has until May 31st to either withdraw his name from the NBA draft or stay in the draft, in which case he would not be eligible to return to college. He has one season of eligibility remaining. It's a bit of a complicated situation. Not really complicated, but, you know, it's probably a somewhat tough decision for Eric Dixon because from all indications, I think he's ready to begin his professional career. However, there's the financial aspect where, in all likelihood, he would make more money through a name, image, and likeness deal being back at Villanova next season. He's likely not going to be drafted in either the first or the second round of the NBA draft. He would have to latch on through a summer league or an NBA, summer league or the G League. However, he was not invited to either the NBA scouting combine or the G League scouting combine, which makes his odds even longer. So potentially, I would think his options would be to either pursue a career overseas beginning this year or return to Villanova. I think if he was to return to Villanova, he would only help improve his draft stock. I think it probably would be in his best interest to return, both financially and from potential future in the NBA. However, you know, there's also the aspect of sometimes you're ready to move on. So we'll just have to wait and see what happens with Eric Dixon. Did put out a poll on Thursday on social media, Aaron underscore Bracy on X, and 55% of our voters said they do not think he will return, and 45% obviously then said they did think he will return. So we'll just have to wait and see here what happens with Lowry. A couple other items I'd like to get to before we get to Jackie Spiegel, who's going to be joining us to talk about Philadelphia Flyers. Eagles had their offensive and defensive and special teams coordinators speak to the media on Thursday. Basically what you'd expect them to say, how they're excited, looking forward to the season, et cetera, et cetera. So nothing really newsworthy, as far as I could tell, came out of those conversations. But I did find it interesting that defensive coordinator Vic Fangio, who's going to be entering his 38th NFL season, and thanks to Chris McPherson from PhiladelphiaEagles.com for his story, which helped provide me this information. Definitely go check out his story at PhiladelphiaEagles.com. But he's entering his 38th NFL season, 21st as a defensive coordinator. And I did not realize that Vic Fangio started his career, or early in his career, worked as a defensive assistant for the Philadelphia Stars of the USFL in 1984, 85, and 86 before the league, I think, folded then. I remember that team growing up. I guess, I would have been 8 or 9 years old then in 84, 85, and I do remember the Philadelphia Stars. I think I might have even gone to a game or two at the Vet. Fun team, fun league. And Vic Fangio is looking forward to finishing his career, he said, in Philadelphia, kind of where he started it, or where it early in his career began. So we'll keep our tabs on the Eagles. We'll have more Eagles guests on our podcast here. If you missed episode 6 of our podcast, we were joined by Jeff Kerr of CBS Sports, covers the Eagles, does a great job covering the Eagles, also the Phillies. You can go back and listen. We talked Eagles and NFL draft on that podcast. So today, again, we're going to be joined shortly by Jackie Spiegel of the Inquirer to talk Flyers. It was a really interesting season for the Flyers, and we'll talk more with Jackie about this, but they were like exceeding expectations for most of the season, until the last couple weeks where they lost 10 of their final 14. And there were a lot of issues down the stretch. And John Tortorella, obviously being the fiery coach that he is, he's a bit of a lightning rod, both in the league and I guess in his own locker room. And, you know, he had the Flyers playing great. And then on March 19th, he benched Captain Sean Couturier for 2 games, healthy scratch. And the Flyers finished 4-10 from that point. During that stretch, he also questioned the Flyers' heart in a 4-3 overtime loss to the Islanders on April 1st. And this is a direct quote: "If you don't have enough balls to play in these types of games, then you're not doing us any good." The last part was paraphrased. I can't read my own handwriting. The first part is definitely what he said. Sometimes I have chicken scratch. But it seemed like there were some issues in the clubhouse, in the room, as they say. Clubhouse would be baseball. And then after the season, he admitted that he could have done some things differently. For me, like, I don't think you bench your captain as a healthy scratch. I think that's a really dangerous thing to do. I think it backfired on him. I think that much is clear. I also think you have to be careful the way you phrase things when you're talking about players' effort. I think saying that they didn't have enough balls to play in these types of games, I really don't think that's going to sit well with players. Now, I'm guessing John Tortorella doesn't necessarily care how it sits with players. However, it's his job to motivate players in a way to be successful. And obviously down the stretch, that didn't happen. I also, and I'm going to talk to Jackie about this, wonder about a comment that came out after the season in which I think Tortorella said that him and Couturier disagree on a lot of stuff, which is fine. You're not going to see eye to eye on everything. But generally, I would think you would want to have a good relationship with your captain so that you can move things forward. So a lot of issues on the table to talk with Jackie about the Flyers. And we will have Jackie coming up just in a moment here. So hang on a second, and we'll be joined just in a moment by Jackie Spiegel from the Philadelphia Inquirer. And now we're pleased to be joined on the Bracy Sports Media Podcast, Episode 8, by Jackie Spiegel, who does a great job of covering the Philadelphia Flyers for the Philadelphia Inquirer. Jackie, thanks so much for joining us today.
Aaron, thanks for having me. Really appreciate it.
Oh, it's great to talk to you, Jackie. And I just want to thank you because you were so kind to me last year covering Flyers games. And I really appreciated your kindness. And it was a lot of fun to talk to you about Flyers. And I learned a lot about the game because you know so much. So I just want to thank you, first of all.
Oh, I appreciate that. I think, you know, the feeling's mutual, you know, as someone who was new to the beat, new to the area, you know, you were great to sit next to and to work with. And I will say, like, everyone was, you mm-hmm. know, I felt very welcomed coming here when I moved very, very quickly from New York to come here.
Well, Jackie's done a great job. She has a lot of hockey knowledge from her background. And so, Jackie, I know you were up at Lehigh on Thursday, and I guess they're still playing. I haven't been following it, but maybe you could give our listeners an update on what's going on at Lehigh and what you have coming down the pike at the Inquirer before we get into the Flyers.
Sure, yeah. I went up to Lehigh. It's the first time I've been able to get up there because, you know, with travel and everything with the covering the Flyers. So they're actually still in the Calder Cup playoffs. They're in the second round. They are playing Hershey, so another Pennsylvania team. And they beat Wilkes-Barre in the first round. So, you know, it's kind of running the Philadelphia gamut right now. But, yeah, so I went on Wednesday. So I went for 2 days of practice, and then I went Wednesday. They had their game, and they were actually down 2-0 in the series at the time. And were able to beat Hershey, who has a really strong team. I don't know if you're aware. They're the Washington Capitals.
I know they're like rivals, right? Those guys.
Yeah, I don't. To be honest, I'm assuming just because they're Pennsylvania, also their rivalry, like Pittsburgh and Philadelphia. But regardless, Hershey's a really strong. I mean, they won it. I think it was last year that they won it, the Calder Cup. You know, they have a lot of guys who were just playing for the Washington Capitals in the playoffs that were sent down. So they're a really strong team. So it wasn't surprising that they went out to a 2-0 lead in the best of five. But then the Phantoms actually won on Wednesday. They won 2-0. Cal Peterson got a shutout. Ula Lixell and Emil Andre got the goals, and they were power play goals. And I can tell you, like, pretty much the entire Flyers staff was there on Wednesday watching Danny Briere, Barry Hanrahan, Brent Flair, Al McCauley, John Tortorella was there, Rocky Thompson was there. So they had a whole slew of guys watching the young guys. And so they play again on Saturday. Well, they'll have to again win to push it to a game five, the equivalent of a game seven. So, but yeah, got a couple of stories, talked a lot to Bobby Brink, talked a lot. We went over a lot of the season and his ups and downs and being sent down and how he handled everything. Talked to Emil Andre. I was really impressed with his game, by the way, on Wednesday. He played all situations, had a good stick, was really strong with, I saw him directing traffic, which I think is really impressive for a young kid to be doing that. And he and I had talked a lot about, like, his mental health and where he sees the game and mm-hmm. where he sees his game fitting in. So, you know, great stuff from him. Talked to the new guys, Hunter McDonald and Massimo Rizzo, who basically just left college. So very new experience for them. Massimo's not playing right now because he's injured, but still good for him to be around the team. And I also talked to Samu Tuamala, who also is a little hurt right now, a little banged up. But, you know, like, we talked also about his up and down season. And, you know, it's really tough for him and Emil. They are two guys that played in, you know, European leagues before the season, primarily in European leagues, I should say, before the season. And they don't play as many games as they play over here. So it's been, you know, like they, like Ian Lamperrier said, they hit the wall a little bit. But then they kind of got back on track. So good stuff coming from them. Talked a lot about mental health. Talked a lot about how they see the game. How it's not just a physical game. It's also like you have to be in the right headspace. So I thought those were some really interesting stuff from some guys that are pretty young.
And we're talking to Jackie Spiegel from the Philadelphia Inquirer. You can follow Jackie on social media at Jackie Spiegel, S-P-I-E-G-E-L 93. Her coverage, you can find at inquirer.com/flyers. Jackie, you mentioned power play goals. You did not see many of those this year in Philadelphia. But I want to talk about the Flyers. And so there's some big issues. And I guess foremost on my mind is their finish. They finished 4-10. They were right in the hunt for a playoff spot and then really just kind of collapsed down the stretch.
Yeah.
What do you think caused that? From your perspective, what were the biggest issues?
Well, I think the one glaring thing, and everyone knows it, is the defense was really banged up towards the end, right? You had Jamie Drysdale get hurt in Pittsburgh at the end of February. We all know Travis Sanheim was pretty banged up. We know Cam York was banged up. Nick Seeler, you know, had the lower body injury that kept him out for a couple weeks. And then obviously the trade of Sean Walker really, I don't think it would have had as big an impact, the trade, if Nick Seeler had been healthy. Because remember, Nick Seeler literally got hurt like the day before they traded him. So I think, and Jamie Drysdale got hurt like a week before they traded him. So I think the trade wouldn't have made such a big impact if it had, you hadn't had all these other things going on, if that makes sense. So, you know, I think, you know, that kind of caused a lot of issues on the back end. And you had Cam York and Travis Sanheim, two guys who were, like I said, were a little banged up, playing massive minutes. Massive minutes. And their numbers, because of that, they don't look great because, you know, they were up on the ice for a lot of goals against, but that was also they were playing against the top, you know, top lines or whatever. So, but I think there was that part, you know, there was, you know, Sam Ersson played a lot of games. There was not an expectation of him playing that many games this season at the NHL level. And yes, he's played more games between Lehigh Valley and I think it was the Flyers last year. Or whatever. You know, like he's played a lot of games before in a season. But as much as you respect the American Hockey League, it is a little bit of a slower pace. And, you know, it's not as quick and it's not as maybe as reactionary as the NHL is because of the speed of the game. So, you know, now he's in the NHL and as John Tortorella has said, there was no expectation of him even starting more than 20 games. And then he ended up with 51. So, you know, I think he kind of hit a little bit of a wall too. And then there's always the question marks about like John Tortorella's message and how that impacted the team, scratching Sean Couturier for a couple of games. I don't think that had as much as an impact as everyone thinks, being in the Philadelphia market, because, you know, outside the market, everyone was like, oh, my God, oh, you know, like, everyone was very like, how do you scratch your captain, blah, blah, blah. And Sean Couturier knows, like, he sat there saying he knows he wasn't playing as well as he could have been. And I think he hit a wall, too, right? I mean, the guy missed almost 2 years of hockey. And, you know, I was incredibly impressed with this game when he came back. You know, I think you and I even talked about it in the press box. I'm not someone who's specifically watched Sean Couturier's game before this season, right? Because I was covering more of a national, you know, the entire NHL. And for some of my jobs, I was more focused on the Canadian team. So I really wasn't focusing on Sean Couturier and the Philadelphia Flyers. But I will say, watching Sean Couturier at the beginning of the year, I was incredibly impressed with his game. And I was like, oh, okay, I get it now. I get the defensive center. I get how good he is at playing that position. So, Yeah, I think it was just like, it was just a multitude of things. And there were also other teams were just playing better at the time too, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like the Islanders stepped up their game. I mean, they made the coaching change and had Patrick Waugh, and, you know, I don't think anyone wants to make Patrick Waugh mad. So I think his team kind of stepped it up a little bit. And, you know, Montreal, they played really well against the Flyers, those two games. I think it was just everything kind of came at the same time.
And we're talking to Jackie Spiegel, who covers the Flyers for the Philadelphia Inquirer. And just last point on the Tortorella before we get into some off-season stuff. And you mentioned that the maybe the in your mind the Couturier thing didn't have as big of an impact as maybe some people on the national stage thing thought. I also thought during that stretch I was surprised they lost to the Islanders at home 4-3 in overtime. And after that game, as you I'm sure you recall, Tortorella said that he kind of questioned the players' guts. I'm using guts as there was another word that he used there. But what if any impact do you think that had on the team? And like where do you think the Tortorella players relationship is at this point? Is it a problem? Is it something? I know he probably doesn't really care about the relationship from what I can tell. But do you think there are going to be any issues going forward with John Tortorella as the coach of this current group of players?
I don't know. It's hard to gauge. I think a lot of guys respect John Tortorella. I mean, look, John Tortorella comes with a massive resume.
Mm-hmm.
And he knows what he's doing, and he pushes teams. And everyone. And I think what's catching up with John Tortorella now, and he's mentioned it a few times, especially when we're in Voorhees at practices or morning skates, is that his reputation is kind of catching up with him a little bit,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, you know, he comes in with a reputation of doing certain things and creating certain, let's just say, drama, for lack of a better term. And mm-hmm. he knows that his, I think he's really starting to recognize that his reputation precedes him. But that doesn't mean that that's who he is. And I think, you know, will it impact the team moving forward? I don't know. I don't know how much that really impacted the room necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
As someone who, so I worked at SNY for a number of years, so I was in the New York market. So I saw a lot of John Tortorella's press conferences. That was old school John Tortorella,
mm-hmm.
right? That was the guy who stood there and would talk about Sidney Crosby and Evgeny Malkin after he played the Penguins as a Rangers coach. This is a guy who has called out his players before during that tenure when he was with New York, especially, that I remember. Mm-hmm. So that wasn't something I was shocked by because I've seen him do this before. And yes, today's – and he talks about it too. Like, he has to change his style of coaching now too for today's players. So maybe 15 years ago, 20 years ago when he did it, the guys were different than they are now.
Mm-hmm.
They take it in a little differently. Because back then, what was it? Coach was always right, right? So I don't know how much it impacts the room, to be honest with you. I've seen some people speculate that kind of was what caused some of the issues down the stretch. But I've also been in the room, and mm-hmm. I saw, because they played the Islanders. And then, if I remember correctly, let me pull up the schedule real quick. I believe that was, then there was the Montreal-New York trip right after that.
It was in the middle of an 8-game losing streak. I think they ended up beating the Rangers.
The Ranger game was before. I was going to say, because I've been in the room, and, like, the room is very, the room is a good room.
Mm-hmm.
Like, everyone was always in a good mood, relatively speaking. They played the Islanders, and then there was like a bit of a lull because they had 3 days off in between, or not off, but 3 days of no games in between. So, you know, I don't recall much of an issue between that I can recall. Mm-hmm. Cause we were in Buffalo that Friday, mm-hmm. and I did miss a practice or two cause of travel. Yeah, I don't know. It's hard to gauge. I mean, the biggest question right now in my mind, Aaron, is that you have really good coaches that are available, right?
Mm-hmm.
And my question is that we all know this is John Tortorella's last stop, right? Like, he said it. Like, he's like, this is the last coaching job I'll ever take. And we know he has been signed for, let's say, I think it's like 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe four. I don't think it was ever announced like how many years he exactly signed for. But we know he was signed for a set number of years. My question is now is that you have all of these amazing coaches that are out there. And I do appreciate the game that Sheldon Keefe coaches, actually. So mm-hmm. If Sheldon Keefe is available, do you pick him now?
Say that quietly to Toronto fans, by the way.
I think there was a bigger issues, and I think it was roster construct mm-hmm. was an issue in Toronto. But and coaches can only do so much, right? Like mm-hmm. they can't go out there and do it for the players. So, you're not changing your game, and you're not the intensity steps up a little bit. But Mitch Marner doesn't appear anywhere. That's not on Sheldon Keefe necessarily, is it?
And And Jackie, we have a few minutes left, but I do want to touch on the offseason. This is obviously a huge offseason for the Flyers. We could go in any different direction. I'm just going to mention a couple things that I think are big, and then you can maybe just fill in the blanks of what you think are important. Obviously, they have Konechny's situation with his contract, Drysdale's health, the goalie situation you mentioned earlier with Ersin and Fedotov, and I guess they have another prospect, Alexei Kolsov. I don't know how he fits into the mix. And then they obviously need more talent. What do you think are the big issues of the offseason, and how do you think they can, will, and I guess need to address them?
Well, I think the biggest issue for this offseason is going, okay, we almost made the playoffs. Do we add the talent now, or do we continue to rebuild
mm-hmm.
from the inside out? And I think that's going to be the struggle between now and when they decide it's not going to be a rebuild anymore. I think that finding the right balance is difficult, right? Like, I think Jake Gensel is available at the end of this year, and Jonathan Marchessault is, and, you have guys that are a little flashy in terms of who they are, what they can bring. It's like, do you want to go get those guys now and lock them in for a couple of years, and hopefully the team's rebuild is done in a year or two, and it keeps pushing the guys to make the playoffs, or do you kind of keep getting young pieces that could, like Jamie Drysdale, who have the potential to be ridiculously good, and have the ability to kind of be cornerstones, like, do you go get those guys now? I think that's like the big question mark, is like, what's the next step in a rebuild? Because you have a team, and it's a great example right now, right? Like, the New York Rangers are a great example of a team that said, we're rebuilding, and then maybe it got accelerated, right? Mm-hmm. And are the Flyers in that spot right now? Because, Danny Briere sat there in the midseason and was like, I don't think anyone expected us to be, I didn't expect us necessarily to be in this position, right?
Mm-hmm.
They were literally in a playoff spot for, 2 months? They were the number 3 seed in the Atlantic. It wasn't even like they were a wild card. So that's a good team to kind of, I know as much as the Rangers, and you don't want to, as a Flyers fan, maybe you don't want to look that in that direction, but it's a good example, right, of what a team can be with a rebuild. Because how many of those guys, Chris Kreider is a homegrown, Shesterkin's a homegrown, Adam Fox, well, not Adam Fox, but he's homegrown because he's from the area, I guess. Braden Schneider, Will Cooley, Matt Rempe, these are all guys that are from their system that have created this base, especially Chris Kreider, right? He's been there for how long now? Like, he's created this base. And then they got talent, right? They got Panarin. They got Trocheck. They got, this is it's a good example of what maybe, as much as I know we all love the word process around here, but, to try to run the process of doing. So, the questions, there was a couple of Anthony DeMarco of the fourth period, talked a little bit about Couturier's contract and whether, now he just got an agent, Pat Bryson, who's obviously, one of the top power agents in the NHL. And you know, there was, you brought up the question mark about like trading contracts, right? Because Sean Couturier is signed for a number of years. And there's other places that have issues with guys, right? Like Jonathan Huberdeau, not really a great fit in Calgary in the end. And he signed for another 7 years, I think. 6 years, 7 years. He signed an 8-year deal when he got there. You know, you have him, you have Mariners, you know, the Leafs obviously have to do something, right? I don't think the core four can continue just because of contracts. Because I think compared to this year and next year, I think like Nylander's making like a 10 or 11 and Matthews is making 10 or 11 and it's just impossible. So you have guys with contracts that they need to swap. So the question is, like, what do you do with Couturier's contract? And do you even move? I mean, look, he is the captain. Do you move Sean Couturier? And he's been here however long. Do you move Scott Laughton? He's always on the tip of everyone's tongue when he's talking about trade stuff. And Konechny, too. Konechny is definitely due for an extension. He's due for a new contract. He has, it doesn't expire until next year, so he's due for an extension right now, which can't be signed until July 1st. The question, you know, he's still only in his 20s. I mean, late 20s, but he's still in his late 20s. You forget how young he is. So, you know, the question is, like, how far do you sign him? And also, like, as Anthony DeMarco brought up, like, if he has another year like he did this year, he's probably going to ask for more money than before next season ends. So do you sign him now or do you wait the year, right, to sign him to a new deal? It's an interesting summer for the Flyers to see which direction they want to take things.
Well, for sure. You should definitely, as you can hear all this knowledge that Jackie's spewing about the Flyers and the NHL all off the top of her head, obviously any NHL and Flyers fan should definitely be following Jackie on Twitter and Threads at Jackie Spiegel, S-P-I-E-G-E-L 93. And you can join me as an Inquirer subscriber to read all of Jackie's coverage. They offer some great deals. I got a great deal a couple months ago. The website is inquirer.com/flyers. Jackie, this was awesome. I can't thank you enough for coming on the Bracy Sports Media Podcast. Thank you so much. And I hope you get to rest a little bit. definitely.
Well, we've got scouting combine coming up, the draft. That's a whole other topic we could discuss, is the draft, because the Flyers do have a number 12 pick. And obviously draft day is always an interesting, or draft, the 2 days are always interesting in terms of teams making trades and deals, trading guys and picks. So, yeah, a lot of good stuff. And then development camp and free agency. So well, maybe in August, Aaron.
Sounds like we have good reason to have you on another time to talk about all that stuff. So thank you so much, Jackie, for joining us. And again, make sure you're following Jackie's coverage. She does such a great job covering the Flyers. And enjoy whatever's, if you're back to Lehigh or getting some rest, Jackie, enjoy it. And thanks again for coming on today.
Thank you. I appreciate it, Aaron.
Well, I really want to thank Jackie Spiegel from the Philadelphia Inquirer for joining us to talk about the Philadelphia Flyers. Obviously, you can tell Jackie has a ton of knowledge, not just about the Flyers, but the NHL and all the names and everything she's rattling off. Like, I've been covering the Flyers for the Associated Press as a freelancer since 1997. It was actually my first professional assignment for the AP, was to help out covering the Flyers. And I was basically a quote, more or less someone who got quotes. And if you can believe this or not, I would call in the box score. It was called Agate, and I would call in the box score in between periods. So there were always two people there for the AP. Now, it's just one AP writer when I cover the games. I'm not calling anything in, and I'm just there by myself and getting the quotes, trying to run to both locker rooms and get some quotes. So it's changed quite a bit. But I still love doing it. And the AP seat at the beginning of the season was next to the Inquirer seat. So got to know Jackie a little bit. And she's a wealth of knowledge for hockey. She is a hockey coach, obviously covered the league from New York. So really a great resource for the Flyers and the NHL. And just really thankful for her to join us today on the Bracy Sports Media Podcast. So that will do it for episode 8 of the Bracy Sports Media Podcast. I would like to thank everyone for listening today. You can find the podcast on Apple and Spotify and wherever, most places where you get your podcast. Also, it is on the Bracy Sports Media YouTube page. You can subscribe there. And we have a big week planned next week as well. We have our three guests planned for a Monday, Wednesday, Friday show. And stay tuned. I will be making an announcement on Wednesday in conjunction with our guest that will be joining us. So stay tuned for that. You can find me on social media at Aaron_Bracy, AARON_Bracy, BRACY. The website is big5hoops.com. I'm working on a book on the 2003-04 St. Joseph's Hawks that will be coming out soon. And I guess that's all for today's show. Thanks again to Jackie for joining us. And most of all, thanks to everyone here for listening. Have a great day, everyone, and I'll talk to you soon.